the strategic objectives. And he's now focusing on a much smaller part of the country. And so we're focused on getting them to be able to succeed in those fights.
Achieve the strategic objectives that the U.S. military and administration thought he had. But he has caused untold misery, violence, and death in that country.
Yes.
The Ukrainian government says he is depopulating the East. He has shipped untold numbers of Ukrainians to Russian camps. So he certainly is achieving objectives by his measure, not the Pentagon's framework. You said you know the clock is ticking. What is that clock? Time is not on your side.
That's right.
So you have some kind of assessment of what that clock is and how much time you have.
We know that the Ukrainians are fighting by the hour.
And the fight changes almost by the hour. And so we are focused on getting them as much help as we can, as much support as fast as we can. Do we have a date on a calendar, Barb, that says, well, by this date, it's going to be over? No. No, and we wouldn't be able to do that. It would be completely irresponsible for us to do that. We know that the Ukrainians are in a live fight, a fight for their country, or a fight for their citizens' lives. And too many, you're right, too many citizens' lives have been taken by this war. But
my last question, is there any administration strategy here? I know there's diplomacy. Is there any Pentagon strategy other than continuing to ship weapons? And how long can you keep
it up? We have two goals, and they have not changed, Barb. Two goals.
Other than shipping weapons.
Our strategy has two components. Let me put it that way then, if you want the word strategy in there. One, it's to help Ukraine defend itself.
And answering that need has changed over time, over the last 90 plus days. You know, earlier we were all about javelins and stingers, and that's all you guys wanted to ask about, and now we're asking about MLRS. I get it. That's the way we have helped Ukraine defend itself has changed over time as the fight has changed over time. And we're going to be committed to this for as long as the Ukrainians need the support. And it's not just us, it's other allies and partners. And the second component, and it's not an insignificant component, we don't talk about it a lot, is making sure we can bolster NATO's eastern flank. We now have over 100,000 U.S. troops in or around the theater in Europe, some at sea, some in the air, some on the ground. Bolster NATO's eastern flank, and should these two other new nations, now Sweden and Finland, become new members of NATO, then that'll be some other commitments that we'll have to make. And so we're focused on that as well, to make sure that Mr. Putin understands that we will, as the president has said, we'll defend every inch of NATO territory.
So MLRS is going the way of the javelins and the stingers, is what I just heard you say, which was, it was a while, and then ultimately it was approved.
No,
that's
kind of
what it just sounded like.
Yeah, nice try.
Yeah, well,
nice try. Go
to go back to the javelins, at the beginning of the war, we heard about the javelins all the time. They were the star. There were photos of javelins.
That is what I just said.
Yes, but photo of javelins, you know, reaching their target and destroying. We don't see anything about the howitzers. So do you assess that the howitzers have reached their objective and are used and help have made the difference on the ground?
All I can tell you is what the Ukrainians tell us, what Mr. Reznikov has told Secretary Austin, and that is that the M777 howitzers have definitely made a significant difference on the battlefield, and they are using them in various places, and they're using them with very good effect.
Do you have an example of a place where they could retake them?
We know, for instance, that they have definitely used them in the Donbass, and that they have, we know that they've used them effectively against Russian formations there in the Donbass. But can I give you an exact date and latitude and longitude? No, I'd refer you to the Ukrainian Ministry of Defense on that. I mean, these howitzers belong to them. They're putting them in the field to defend themselves and their cities and towns and people. And they could speak to that much more definitively than we can. We're not you know, we're not tracking each and every one where they are on the battlefield on any given day, but more than 80 of them, we know this from, because we're getting it from the Ukrainians, more than 80 of them are in forward units being used in combat every day, at least so far. Yeah.
John, Peter Martin from Bloomberg. You talked about the incremental progress that the Russians are making, and I wondered, have you seen them learn from the mistakes they made early on, you know, exposed supply lines, armor vulnerable to more agile Ukrainian infantry? Have they improved the way that they've approached this fight?
We have seen them try to remedy some of the challenges. So, for instance, a good example is logistics and sustainment. I mean, they went so fast on Kyiv in the early days that they outstripped their ability to fuel themselves, feed themselves, resupply themselves. And of course, we remember that vaunted convoy we talked about, and the Ukrainians were able to stop that resupply convoy from ever reaching frontline troops, and it had a significant operational effect on the Russians around Kyiv. In the Donbas, it's a different terrain. It's flatter, it's more open, it's a lot of farmland, small villages and towns. And because it's in the extreme east of the country, it's closer to Russia and closer to their organic supply lines and capabilities. And so they are certainly, you can see them being mindful and wary of getting too far out ahead of their supplies. Part of that's easier for them to do because of the geography and how close they are to Russia and the terrain. But it is, we see a deliberate effort for them to, and you can see it, part of the reason that they're only making incremental gains, obviously it's due to the Ukrainians, but it's also due to their wariness of getting too far afield of their ability to supply themselves. We have seen them try, although with no real success, but you can see them try to get better at integrating ground and air operations. Again, some of that's easier for them to do in a smaller geographic area. They're using smaller units now in smaller places, in smaller movements, and so it's a little bit easier for them to integrate air support for their operations on the ground than it was when they were advancing on three major lines of access, geographically separated by hundreds of miles. So it's a little easier, but we're seeing them start to try to get better at that. I would not go so far as to say we think that they have solved all their air-to-ground integration issues. Command and control, they still suffer. They still have not been able to effectively manage command and control of their units in the field. So, yes, as we said that they would, we have seen them try to improve some of the mistakes, improve upon some of the mistakes they made early on, but they have by no means been able to master them. Christina, good to see you.
Good to see you too. Congrats on your new job.
Thanks.
They're very lucky to have you. I went to follow up on Barb's question. She asked, is this now sort of a slog, a quagmire? Is it bogged down? Would you say this is not a slog? It's a knife fight now. Is the knife fight, you know, sort of like a slog? Where does it go from the knife fight?
Yeah. I think we've been, and I talked about a little bit about this yesterday, I think we're being careful not to slap a label on this or a bumper sticker and say it is this, other than I have said it's a knife fight, and you can see that every day. And I think that's a good descriptor because it's close fighting, and in some cases very intimate, like in Kherson, around Kherson, between Kherson and Mykolaiv, you've got Ukrainian and Russian forces that are very, very close. And it changes every day. So I think we're just going to avoid slapping a label on this. It's war, Christina, and it's close up war. It's brutal, and it's not just brutal on the soldiers. It is, as Barb rightly said, it's been brutal on the population, the people of Ukraine. Joe Gould.
Hey, John. Thanks for taking my question. Question for you. Yesterday we got a readout of Kath Hicks's visit to the UK, and there was a lot of, said about science, technology, and cybersecurity, and security cooperation between the US and UK. But not so long ago, back in September, after the Afghanistan withdrawal, it seemed like US and UK relations were a bit rockier. Would you say that the security situation Right now in Europe has galvanized that relationship or injected new energy into that relationship?
I think I would challenge the assumption that that because of Afghanistan, U.S.-UK relations suffered or were damaged in any way. I mean, the British are there's that we talk about the special relationship, which we firmly, strongly still believe in. I mean, they are tremendous allies and great friends. So I don't think we would associate ourselves with an assumption that there was some sort of damage done to the relationship because of Afghanistan. I mean, we were at war in Afghanistan with the Brits for all of those 20 years. They were with us from the very beginning and right up until the very end, and we helped each other in those 2 weeks of August as we worked together to evacuate literally more than 100,000 people. But to your larger question, I think it's safe to say, fair to say, and evident that Mr. Putin's unprovoked war in Ukraine has definitely helped galvanize the entire alliance and certainly has galvanized in many ways the international community, or at least almost all of the international community, to be mindful not only of the danger Ukraine is in and the support that Ukraine needs, but also the danger to the international rules-based order. We talk about that phrase a lot, and it sounds perhaps bureaucratic, but it's a real thing. It matters. A rules-based international order that we and the British and so many other allies and partners worked so hard to establish in the wake of World War II. I don't think you can say that we grew closer to Great Britain because of this, because we were already exceptionally close. But it's fair to say that our British allies and very much even before Mr. Putin decided to invade saw things the same way, and had multiple conversations about what we were watching Mr. Putin do in the fall and in early weeks of the winter. So there's incredible, I think, synergy between the United States and Great Britain, and I would say go larger than that and say inside the NATO alliance. Yeah, Laura.
Just back on that MLRS, I know that there's two versions. There's one that can travel between 20 and 45 miles, and there's a longer strike version that can reach 190 miles. So what are the concerns about sending Ukraine this longer range version?
I'm just, again, Laura, I appreciate the question. I'm not going to speak to decisions that haven't been made or announced yet with respect to future security packages for Ukraine. I'm just not going to get in there.
Is there, without talking about the package in particular, is there concern that a weapon like this might be provocative to Russia?
We have, since the very beginning, as I said earlier, we've been working closely with Ukraine to provide them the best capabilities we can to help them in the fight that they're in, and that will continue. And the fact that you can do that, but also have a prudent concern over escalation, which we've talked about many, many times, they are not mutually exclusive, and there's no reason for them to be.
Just on a different topic, I saw some reports that Iran has seized two Greek oil tankers. Do you have anything to provide?
I'm afraid
us on
I don't.
That?
Okay. I can take the question, and if there's something that we can offer after the briefing, we can do that. Louis?
Yeah, I don't want to get ahead of a decision. I'd like to get behind a decision if I can.
A decision that hasn't been made yet?
No.
Because that's where we are. We are behind that right now.
Correct. Previous decisions. Can you enlighten us as to how that process actually works? I mean, we've seen the meetings that Joe Milley had with National Security Advisor Sullivan,
yeah,
and their counterparts. So, I mean, how does this originate with the Ukrainians, and what is the Pentagon's role in it? Does it ultimately end up with a recommendation by the Secretary of Defense and then end up as a presidential decision? If you could just capture that for us, please.
Yeah, I mean, so each drawdown package is different, as you guys know. It's different in size, different in kinds of systems and capabilities that are sent. Generally speaking, as a package is being considered, the first input is the Ukrainians themselves, what they say they need, and then are taking a look at that and seeing if we can help meet that need, and if we can't, who can, and then there's a decision made about once we sort of talk about capabilities, then there's a decision about, well, how much right now is, can we get there? Speed is an issue too. And their absorption rate is a fair concern, as well as their consumption rate. So that's why you kind of parcel these out a little bit rather than just send everything in one lump, because you want it to be relevant. So then there's a decision made about, okay, well, how much of X, Y, and Z are we going to send? And where is it going to come from? The drawdown means it comes, it's an authority the president gives us to take stuff off our shelf. It's stuff we've already bought, paid for. It's in a warehouse somewhere, on a base somewhere, overseas or in the United States. So now we know what we want to send and we know kind of how much. Where do we get it from? At the same time that sourcing is being done, obviously you have to have the authority. So the first step as you start thinking about what you want to send is getting permission to do it, and it has to come from the president. It's called presidential drawdown authority for a reason. He will sign out the authority. Okay, I hear what you want to send them. I give you the authority to do that. So that's the next step in the process. Then there's an administrative task. It has to be announced by the Secretary of State. That's the way the system works, because it basically is assistance to a foreign military, and then the Secretary will then issue an executive order to the department to fill that need, and then we're off and running. What has been fascinating for me to watch as I've seen this now go happen now 10 different packages is because we know that time is not our friend. Even as we're filling out the list and doing the sourcing, U.S. Transcom is already planning flights. They're already thinking, okay, if it's going to come from X base here in the United States, then what do I need to do? What do we need to do to make sure we have aircraft on scene as quickly as possible to get it there? And that has been. And we, I'm not saying we were slow at the beginning. They were still getting there pretty quickly, but we have now been able to shorten up the process so that it is literally sometimes as quick as 48 hours before the initial elements of a drawdown package are in the region. Not 48 hours to get to Ukraine, but 48 hours to the region. And sometimes once it gets into the region, it can be in Ukraine 24 to 36 hours after that, which is just an incredible amount of speed. It truly is, we say, unprecedented, and it really is in terms of the ability for the United States to move that much material and get it into the hands of Ukrainian fighters in a matter of just a few days. But it's because now we've done so many of these now, the system, the process works quite well, and the people at U.S. Transportation Command have just been heroic in their ability to identify assets to move that. And it's not all gray tails. I think you know that. They use commercial aircraft as well, but it's still under their auspices. Yeah.
Anson Mercer with the Asahi Shimbun. So it looks like Severodonetsk is going to be the next major urban conflict in the Donbass. The Russians have been trying to encircle it. It's very similar to what they did in Mariupol and maybe choke the city off. What would you assess the Russians' ability to encircle the city has been? Have the Ukrainians been able to halt them at all and keep supply lines open like they did in Kiev? And are you seeing, kind of back on the lessons learned, are you seeing the Russians able to apply some of those lessons learned in an urban assault that we are seeing in Severodonetsk?
They're largely, their operations have stayed largely doctrinal in approach. We haven't seen a lot of adaptations in the way they do maneuver warfare. It's artillery barrages ahead of movement, right? Soak in an area to beat back whatever resistance is there, or prevent, try to prevent Ukrainians from being able to defend. And then once they feel like they've done that, they sort of move out in formation. Now, we've seen those formations being smaller because the terrain is just more confined, and the objectives are going at tend to be a little bit smaller. But it's the same basic idea. I won't predict. We are seeing fighting around Severodonetsk. There's no question about that. And we certainly do assess that the Russians want to take it. But it is, as far as we can see today, still being actively fought over.
And are those counter-artillery batteries that have gone into Ukraine, have those helped Ukrainians be able to target Russian batteries that are assisting in their doctrine of moving forward at all?
I don't want to speak for the Ukrainians and their tactics. We know from talking to them that the howitzers we're providing have been very effective, and they've said so, and that they have made good use of the counter-artillery radars that we have provided and continue to provide. I've only got time for a couple more, and then I'm going to have to go. Yeah, Phil.
Yesterday, you had said that there was the defense attaché in Ukraine, and there would be no U.S. troops fighting inside Ukraine. And I'm just wondering, are you prepared to broaden that out and say that there's no U.S. military mission currently inside Ukraine of any kind beyond the defense attaché there?
What I can tell you is there's a defense attaché at the embassy, and that there is no change to the president's direction that there will be no U.S. forces fighting in Ukraine. And we are in active discussions with the State Department about whether or not it makes sense to have a U.S. military contingent to support their security elements at the embassy, but there's been no decisions about that.
So you're leaving open the possibility of a training mission or...
There's no training mission inside Ukraine right now. And there's been no decisions made about returning trainers to Ukraine. Those same National Guardsmen are conducting training with other elements as well of the U.S. military outside of the country. So certainly not going to walk off the fact that we are conducting training. We are on some of these systems that are going in. But no training in Ukraine right now and no decisions made about returning inside Ukraine. It's a war zone. Okay, I got time for just one more, Rio.
Thank you. I want to follow up about North Korea. Yesterday, the UN Security Council failed to impose new economic sanctions on North Korea. Do you have a sense of urgency to increase deterrence against North Korea by military means, as it is now obvious that the economic measures will not work?
I think, you know, we talked about just in response to this, these multiple ballistic missile launches the other day, we conducted a couple of exercises with both our South Korean and our Japanese counterparts. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about increasing ISR in the region as well. So we're able to, and we'll continue to look for opportunities for an appropriate response from a military perspective, if it makes sense, as they continue to conduct these launches and continue to provoke insecurity and instability on the peninsula. I would remind that those two exercises that we conducted with Japan and South Korea in the wake of the most recent launch were in response to the missile launches. In other words, they were put together and executed very quickly. And that's just, that doesn't happen by accident, Rio. That happens because of good alliance management and prior knowledge and familiarity with one another's military capabilities and the constant training and operating that we do with both our allies. And I think it's remarkable. We talked about, I think you asked me or somebody asked me the other day about the Russians and the Chinese and this bomber exercise, which we assessed was long in the planning and was not a direct response to President Biden's visit over there. By contrast, you know, we were able to act quickly in response to multiple launches by the North just a couple of days ago to put on the table and get in execution a couple of exercises. Again, that's the sign of a healthy, strong, vibrant alliance, and that's the proof in the value of having the network of alliances and partnerships that we continue to try to grow and improve in the Indo-Pacific region. Look, I got to go. Last thing I'll say, and I'll do it quickly so that I can get through it. I just want to thank everybody for what you do. It's important. you don't have to look any further than what's going on in Ukraine and the just the brutality, the vulgarity of the war that Mr. Putin is waging on the Ukrainian people, and the deceitful management of information that he has tried to put in place, shutting down a free flow of information to see how important it is, what a free press can do. And all of you either have been, will be, or you have colleagues who are on the ground in Ukraine right now, putting their own lives in danger. And some of them have been hurt, some of them have been killed. I know that Memorial Day is obviously about memorializing the fallen. I will also promise you I'll take some time this weekend to think about them as well. It's really important, and I just want to thank you for that effort. Thank you for the way you put me through my paces, even today, last day, and I got stretched, I got pushed, but that's what makes you guys so important. That's what makes this place so special. I can't say that every day up here was pleasant, but I can say that I felt, anyway, every day I was up here was meaningful, and that's not because of me. It's because of you. It's because of the questions you asked and the way you pushed and prodded, and not only did your outlets proud, but I think you did the American people proud, and I was proud to have a little piece of it, even if it was just for 18 months. So, again, thank you, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.